thank you. Thank you all for showing up to this exciting, exciting conversation between Dr. Marc Gafni and Andrew Cohen. Today, they will dive deeply and share and explore their deepest insight into the ultimate mystery that lies beyond life and death. And I have the privilege to introduce Marc and Andrew to you today. But before I do that, I want to let you know that afterwards, there's also an opportunity to ask your questions. So as you are listening, I want to invite you, as questions come up, just write them in the chat box and we will read them at the end and share as many questions as we can with Marc and Andrew. So please let me introduce Marc and Andrew to you. Dr. Marc Gafni is a leading public intellectual impacting the source code of global culture. He is a visionary thinker, social activist, and passionate philosopher. He is known for his radical teachings on unique self-enlightenment, the universe, a love story, the phenomenology of eros, and outrageous love. He is, together with Dr. Zachary Stein and their colleagues at the Center for Integral Wisdom, focused on writing The Great Library, which articulates a set of first principles and first values that serve as the ground for a new story, which can in turn ground a global ethos for a global civilization at this moment of significant existential risk. Marc Gafni is the author of 10 books, including the award-winning Your Unique Self, The Radical Path to Personal Enlightenment. He holds his doctorate in philosophy from Oxford University, as well as his rabbinic ordination. He is the co-founder with Ken Wilber of the Center for Integral Wisdom, where he serves as president together with Dr. Zachary Stein. He also serves in a similar role at the Foundation for Conscious Evolution. Together with the late Barbara Marx Hubbard, he co-founded One Mountain, Many Paths, a global communion of pioneering souls committed to articulate first principles and first values, a new story for a new humanity. Or as Barbara and Mark said it together, a planetary awakening in love through unique self symphony. One Mountain is a community that meets weekly to participate in articulating and evolving the source code of culture based on these first values and first principles aggregated through the ages and clarified and evolved to engage the very real existential challenges and possibilities in this 11th hour of humanity. Dr. Marc Gafni and Barbara Marx Hubbard have devoted their entire lives to articulate the most precise, impactful integrations of sacred teachings throughout history, so we can each show up to One Mountain and leave enthralled by our oneness, purpose, and potential. Now, Andrew Cohen is a spiritual teacher, an author, cultural visionary, and inspirational speaker. Andrew's work has been acclaimed by luminaries worldwide, from academics to philosophers to teachers of all faiths and none. From 1991 to 2010, he was editor-in-chief of the award-winning Enlightened Next magazine, a widely cherished publication that explored the deepest existential questions of our time with some of the world's most noted thought leaders. Andrew has become known for his willingness to boldly cast aside the sacred cows of the spiritual world. His work grapples with demystifying the wealth of knowledge found in the great wisdom traditions and with making enlightenment deeply relevant to a postmodern audience. In 2020, he and a small group of collaborators launched the online project Manifest Nirvana, a virtual ashram and monastery of the future, which Andrew has called a home for sovereign souls, radical spirits, and integral pioneers. In his three decades of teaching and lecturing, he has developed a unique and powerful vision for a truly contemporary spirituality, combining evolutionary theory and integral developmental practice with the timeless wisdom of the perennial philosophy. Departing radically from a traditional Eastern approach, Andrew's pioneering Dharma, evolutionary enlightenment, calls not for a transcendence of the world, but for a deep and heroic responsibility for its evolution. It is my pleasure to give my word to you, Andrew Cohen, to open this wonderful dialogue. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. It's wonderful to be with all of you. So before Marc and I start on our planned dialogue for tonight, I wanted to just say that I wanted to introduce a concept that Marc and I have spoken about together called Game B. And Jim Rutt, who's the former head of the Santa Fe Institute, came up originally with this idea. Game B basically tells us that if humanity is going to survive, we have to find a new way to do things together. We have to find a new way to work together. We have to find a new way to be together. We have to find a new way to relate to each other. And so my intention and Marc's intent, one of my intentions and one of Marc's intentions for this dialogue series, which we're going to be enacting every 2 months together, is to try to enact transparently, personally, publicly, what Game B is all about. And Game B is an idea that tells us that there's a different way of being together. And it's a way of being together that I think all the great religious spiritual traditions and mystical traditions point to. And it says that there's a way of being together that is non-competitive. There's a way of being together in which we have found a relationship to life and a relationship to being alive, where we truly want the welfare and the happiness and the liberation and the enlightenment and the fulfillment of the other and the others as much as we are seeking for ourselves. And the idea goes that for all of human history, Game A has been the rule in all fields of human endeavor, that we've fundamentally been competing against each other for survival in so many different ways and so many different contexts. And we know how hard it is for human beings to really love each other deeply, to trust each other deeply, to work together in a spirit of love and mutuality. So one of the things that Marc and I discussed, that we want to be a part of this new adventure that we're on together doing these dialogues, is to enact in our relationship with each other in public an attitude of mutual care that is truly one in which we are seeking for the welfare and the well-being and the success and the enlightenment of the other and the others as much as we're seeking for our own. And so we're very much hoping that over the months that we're doing this, months or years, however long this is going to end up lasting, that we will be able to put this idea of Game B into practice in our relationship with each other, in our relationship with all of you, and hopefully ignite a spirit of mutuality that is very rare in human life, because love is a very difficult thing to follow through on. It's easy to fall in love, but it's difficult to stay in love. And it's difficult for us to treat each other with a deep sense of care and compassion and kindness and mutuality, especially when we're having difficulties, we're facing challenges together. So we want the way we enact our relationship with each other and our relationship with all of you and whatever this is going to lead to be an expression of reaching for a higher human potential, a potential that human beings, I think, have been reaching for thousands of years. And as we all know now, with all the problems that we're facing, this kind of spirit is needed more than ever. So that's the initial introduction I wanted to give. I think Marc wanted to comment before we begin our planned subject. And I'm very much looking forward to this. And and since Marc and I have been speaking together over the last couple of years, he's shown me a lot of kindness. And so I think that this attitude of kindness and mutual care and mutual respect is what brought us to the point that we actually wanted to do this. So I hope that we'll be able to share this kind of mutual care in such a way that it will become infectious and all of you will begin to feel the enormous human potential inherent for all of us when we really care about each other. Okay, Marc.
Thank you, Andrew. Thank you. At first, it's good to be here with you. And it's been a, who was it who said, was it Bob Dylan, what a long, strange road it's been, right? So life is a long and a strange road. And we started, I think our first meeting was back in 2002 or 2003, where our friend Ken introduced us at some point. And here we are in 2000. So it's good to be with you and it's good to be with everyone. And maybe just a couple of, you know, brief comments on your setting, your contextual setting, which is completely beautiful. And we've talked about it a lot and completely accurate. Maybe just to share two things in that context. I do want to say that, you know, in terms of the notion of non-competitiveness, right? I am, you know, as I've mentioned to you in the last 2-3 days, very, very jealous of your glasses. You have like great glasses. I'm dealing with that. I'm working with that issue, like those really great new glasses. And so I feel like I need to get new glasses. But other than that, I think we can make it, right? So here's the first point. First one is conversation. And conversation is such a big deal. In the original Hebrew lineage, the word for conversation is Messiah, Mashiach, Messiah. And Messiah is the notion that matter triumphs in life, the first Big Bang to the second Big Bang, life triumphs in self-reflective mind, right? Second Big Bang to the third Big Bang, but there's a fourth Big Bang. And Messiah means a new human, a new humanity, right? Game B, right? A new possibility. And that notion that the word Messiah, Mashiach, and Siach in conversation mean the same thing is so beautiful and so significant, because what is life other than a series of conversations? I mean, the monad of life is conversation, right? The structure of life, and its conversation, not just between human beings. Our friend Howard Bloom writes beautifully about a conversational cosmos, right? The conversations that take place from the originating nanoseconds of the Big Bang. And so to change the nature of conversation is to change the source code itself. And so that's a very, very big deal. And maybe just the second brief thing, and then turning to you to get us started. If we would try and identify, right, Andrew, right, and we've talked about this a lot, the root cause, right, underneath everything, right, all the multiple, multifactorial dimensions that have brought us to this point between utopia and dystopia, as we face both enormous possibility of gorgeousness unheralded in human history and potential dystopia, a catastrophic risk and existential risk, right, unheralded in human history. What's the core underlying root cause generator function, if you will? And there's probably two of them. I'll just mention one as part of our kind of setting. And that is that we're governed by a success story. And that success story is governed by a win-lose metrics. And that win-lose metrics operates all the way up and all the way down, game A, which you refer to as game A. And even in conversations, even in dialogues, even in spirit gets commodified and sold and lists are exchanged, and spirit happens to be what is discussed, but underneath you can actually sense that game A is still playing. So if we want to evolve the source code, it's all the notes and the beautiful notes we've been able to exchange with each other over the last, you know, bunch of years. And it's the way that we be together. And so I'm just delighted to be here with you. I'm delighted to love you and to honor you and to be in this conversation and to do it for the sake of the evolution of love, which at its core is the evolution of conversation. So here we go.
Amen, beautiful. So what we wanted to talk about on this kickoff, a dialogue together, is we wanted to talk about the ultimate secret that exists beyond life and death. And I want to speak just briefly about this mystery, this secret. So all the great religious traditions and mystical schools tell us in their own different ways that there is an ultimate secret, an ultimate mystery, and that the knowledge or the discovery of this ultimate mystery will free us from the fear of death and will free us ultimately, radically, and completely. And this is very profound. So when the Buddha experienced his enlightenment, he said that he discovered a depth dimension that he called the unborn and the uncreated. In the modern spiritual master Eckhart Tolle calls this depth dimension the ground of being. And this points to the deepest dimension of reality that exists before time, before the universe was created, before the universe was a thought in the mind of God. There existed no thing whatsoever, this primordial voidness or primordial emptiness. But this primordial voidness and this primordial emptiness is alive, is the source of life and the source of existence and the source of consciousness itself. So the Buddha discovered on the night of his enlightenment that the source of everything that exists exists prior to the existence of everything. And the idea is that the discovery of this primordial source of everything that exists will liberate us from fear, liberate us from attachment, and liberate us from the fear of death. So one way to look at this question is to look at it through this ancient lens of the discovery of this depth dimension that the Buddha called the uncreated and the unborn, and what we call the ground of being. So if we truly awaken to this depth dimension, we will experience freedom from time, freedom from fear, and freedom from the passing away of our physical form. And so this has been a big theme in, of course, the Eastern traditions. And this was the kind of experience I was looking for when I was a young seeker. So that's one side of the picture. Now, one thing that Marc and I share very much in common is we're both evolutionary mystics. And we both teach our particular version of our metaphysical spirituality very much in the context of evolutionary theory. So what's so exciting about the discovery of evolution is that we discover that there is a great continuity. There is an absolute continuity, a cosmic continuity. That everything that exists is part of everything else that exists. And that everything that exists, which is part of everything else that exists, is on a journey of becoming. And so when we discover this dimension or aspect of evolution, this is very liberating, because we realize that from this primordial emptiness, this primordial voidness, this primordial nothingness, there was a big cosmic explosion, like Marc was just referring to as the Big Bang. And this big bang gave rise to a great continuity. And this is a continuity of becoming. And so when we realize this intellectually, it's one thing, but when we awaken to this, through the fact of this continuity internally as an inner subjective fundamental nature of all of reality, that all of reality is part of a continuity, a becoming that is literally infinite. It's also very liberating, because we realize that this particular version of this continuity that this body, this mind, and this personality is experiencing is a very small part of a very big process. And so when we have our transcendental moments of awakening to evolution as a direct subjective experience, we know directly that we're part of a process that's infinite, that's going somewhere extraordinary and profound, and that we're part of all that, and that there's nothing to fear, because we've been at this for a long time, and we're going to be here until this process comes to its ultimate conclusion. And what the ultimate conclusion of the greater process is a matter of speculation for physicists and also for metaphysicians. And maybe that's something we could talk about later if we get to that. But these two forms of spiritual enlightenment, which is the enlightenment of the Buddha, which is the realization that at the deepest level, he'd never been born and never entered the stream of time, and that he was always free. This is one powerful expression of enlightenment. And the other, and the one that Marc and I share more closely, is this awakening to this great continuity, to this extraordinary process perspective in which we realize that we're part of something glorious, magnificent, and profound that has been in progress for a long time and is going to be in progress for a very long time into the infinite future. And if we can relax into this knowledge, it can be a source of enormous inspiration for us to live this life with great courage and great fearlessness.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you. No, that's, I mean, what better context, right? The context of everything in relation to death. And then we absolutely have to do a full conversation on these two dimensions. It's the ground of everything. And this being becoming conversation, Whitehead's great words is something we've had over the years, and it's evolved and it's deepened. And I madly look forward to deepening there. Let me see if in this context of death, I can pick up one small piece of it, but first to kind of step back, you know, and to just kind of create some context about where I'm just kind of thinking out loud where we might go. So let me, and what we're going to try and do, everyone, is we're going to try and just generally speak about the same amount of time and kind of go back and forth and kind of weave together right as we go. And we also kind of made a decision to, this is something we've both thought about a lot, to kind of be in the moment and let the dialogue emerge as it emerges. So let's see if we can just follow the thread. At the same time, we have a commitment to try and articulate source code. We might call it a word, source code principles that actually begin to invoke, right, a new conversation and begin to invoke what I like to call a universal grammar of value, right, which transcends and includes the best of pre-modern, modern, and postmodern, but actually becomes something new and emergent because we're at a time which is new and emergent. And we desperately need a global ethos for a global civilization. And we can't have that conversation without starting with death. So I'll share with you, Andrew, something we haven't gotten to talk about in our few conversations the last few months. I started thinking about death again, like almost all of us did, when COVID started. And all of a sudden, I mean, yesterday, I looked it up for 1 second before we started. And it's the kind of thing you look up today. I remember when I grew up, we saw how many people had died that day in Vietnam, right? In, you know, mid, late 60s, right? You look up and yesterday, 10,172 people died in the world of COVID. And it's kind of a shocking notion. And something happened in COVID. We somehow addressed it in a particular way, unlike the rest of the crises of the world. And so before COVID, last year, there were tragically 10 million children who died, right? There were opioid epidemics, right? There was obesity, there was depression, there were a million suicides, right? So it's not like the world was without crisis, but something happened in COVID and the world mobilized. And the world mobilized not just because there was an identifiable target that we could perhaps control so we could actually engage it, but I think the world mobilized because in some sense, no one was out of the circle of death. Right. I mean, no, in some sense, right. I mean, no one was excluded. We could always say that was them, right? In our own egoic structured minds, right? Unrealized minds, it was them. We could split off from it. We could engage it for a short time a day. But all of a sudden, the skull grins at the banquet and no one's excluded. And although obviously we've seen tragically that COVID has distributed unequally based on race and socioeconomic status, which is a fracture line in the world today in general, and COVID has accentuated that. So it's not quite true that there's equal suffering. That's actually not true. But at least theoretically, the skull grinned and grins at everyone's banquet. And so all of a sudden, we have to kind of confront death again. And I want to see if I can just in 2 minutes, and I'll ping it back to you to take you either in a different direction or to, you know, we'll play with this context. So there's a kind of what we might call a first shock of existence. And in the first shock of existence is we confront death, right? Dawn man is handling the bison and the tigers and like every other biological species. And then there's this awareness of death, right? There's this existential awareness. Okay, there's death, right? That's a huge demarcating moment in history. And we might call that the first shock of existence. And then this first shock of existence presses us into gnosis, knowing. We turn inward. We begin to examine reality, right? The spirit that moves in us, right, generates gnosis in response to death, right? Death actually makes life, right, a genuine option that we have to engage in an entirely different way. We're not in the picture of Dorian Gray. We don't live for, right? We're going to die. And so we go inside and we engage death, and the religions come up with enormous, gorgeous, not myths, not superstitions, but actually depth truths of cosmos, interior sciences that actually unfold, right, a vision in which we can live with death. And then what happens is we go through era after era, and then we hit modernity, and all of a sudden the religions get undone, right? All of a sudden we were consoled in our relationship to death. We had a framework within which to live, and then all of a sudden it gets undone, begins to get undone in the beginning of modernity. Then in comes hyper-modernity. Hyper-modernity is post-modernity, which then deconstructs all the rest of the structures. And all of a sudden, there's no story of death. We face our deaths without a story of death. And by story, I don't mean fanciful conjecture, without an interior knowing of how to walk through it. So all of a sudden we get hit with COVID-19, and the entire world is faced with death, and we're unconsoled because all the structures that had worked for millennia and that had guided us, for most people, are unavailable. And even people within religions, right? There's a creeping cynicism, a creeping dogmatic materialism that undermines that easy sense of being consoled, even when you live in a tradition. And so we face COVID unconsoled, right? Right? The skull grins at the banquet once again. And in some sense, we have to now become the prophets and seers again and actually engage again death, as it were, for the first time, and reconfigure, pressed by death again, right? And reconfigure our response to death, right? But in a way which takes into account everything that we know in all these generations, pre-modern, modern, and post-modern, and actually articulate this new response to death. So how does that sound for, that's what I was thinking about last year. I put it aside. You know, I wrote for a few months and put it aside, but it's been with me kind of in my dreams, right? This need to configure, right, this new response to death. So I'm going to put that on the table and let's see where we go.
Well, I think what you're saying is true. And I think that modernity, the emergence of modernity itself, has been called the period of disenchantment or the disenchantment. So of course, when we discovered rationality in the Western Enlightenment, we were able to explore the outer world in ways we never could before. And we started to innovate, and in the most extraordinary ways, and science has opened up so many possibilities. Human creativity has reached epic levels, and this has been the most extraordinary leap forward in human history, the Western Enlightenment, and it continues to be. Except I think you're very right, we're coming to the point where we've reached the limits of our, we've reached the limits of our capacities, because we are innovating faster than we're morally prepared to deal with the consequences of what we're actually giving rise to. And this is creating an existential and spiritual crisis for our species. One that more and more of the human race is waking up to now, as we're facing, you know, the ecological devastation that's happening. And more and more people seem to be realizing that we definitely might not make it. We might be in the midst of destroying ourselves. So this is true. And I think that for people our age, I'm just a little bit older than you. I grew up as a secular Jew in New York, so I was a very spiritually disenchanted young man, and I was a materialist as a young person, without even realizing it. And so a big part of my own spiritual longing, my spiritual search, was a search for enchantment. I wanted spiritual liberation, but spiritual liberation and searching for a spirit, searching for enchantment, is one and the same thing. And so when we wake up, when we actually find what we're looking for and we truly wake up, in whatever tradition or system we're working within, when the universe becomes re-enchanted for us, when our own experience of consciousness becomes re-enchanted, it changes everything, and we We know two things. We know, number one, that whatever happens, it's always okay. At a deep metaphysical absolute level, we realize that it's always okay, and that we're going to be okay, and that there's absolutely nothing to fear, no matter what appears to be happening in the realm of manifest existence. And we also realize that to exist, and this relates to our mutual interest in Eros and evolution as an expression of God, we realize that God or Absolute Spirit created the universe, and she is, in essence, in her manifest form, pure positivity, unadulterated, absolute, undefiable, pure positivity. So when we experience that the explosive nature of that pure positivity, that is the nature of God herself, pulsating and vibrating through us, within us, and around us, we realize that to exist is good, even if bad things happen in the process, and they always can, and they always do, and they will. And even if we mess things up, as we seem to be in the process of doing, in spite of that, to exist is still good. The fact that the universe exploded into being and is continuing to do so is still an expression of pure positivity, even in the midst of all the crises that we're facing due to our own ignorance and lack of development. So that knowledge that number one, everything is always okay, and number two, that to exist is good, re-enchants us metaphysically and spiritually to the deepest level of our being, and becomes a source of great strength, I believe, to fight the good fight. It empowers us to be able to be here in the face of so many overwhelming challenges. And we're all in our own way facing these overwhelming challenges, and more the human race is waking up to the fact that these overwhelming challenges are getting bigger and bigger. So I think that that the awakening to the absolute nature of spirit and the re-enchantment that happens to us at a soul level becomes a source of empowerment. And not an empowerment to survive, you know, unaffected by the existential challenges of postmodern and post-postmodern existence, but as a source of strength to ultimately fight the good fight, because I think ultimately that's what we're here for, is to fight the good fight, and from an evolutionary point of view, do everything we possibly can within our means to make the world a better place. I ultimately believe that when we shift from Maslow's survival needs to being needs, that we ultimately discover that the ultimate source of meaning is found through being here for the purpose of making this world the best world it possibly can be. I believe that's ultimately why we're here, and ultimately we'll find our liberation through that discovery.
Yeah, no, beautiful. So let me pick up from a few things you said and see if we can kind of create a context. So we want to approach gorgeous, right? Completely with you. So we want to approach death. And intuitively, you walk through a particular door. And I want to unpack what that door is and try and create maybe the door frame a little bit. Okay. So when we approach death today, there's three, you know, as I was thinking about it last year, and I'm in my dreams last night. So I specifically, as we agreed, didn't go back to my notes from last year. So I'm kind of trying to organize it clearly in my head, but it's very beautiful, right? There's three doors we could enter. One door, and maybe we'll do a separate dialogue on this. One door is the enormous wealth of information today available about psychokinesis, precognition, reincarnation, near-death experiences, telepathy, right? The entire world of psi phenomena that William James and Henry Sedgwick, you know, started 130 years ago, the psychical research actually gives us empirical information about the continuity of consciousness that's never been available today in history. So I just want to put that on the side for a second. So we're not at this moment going through that door. So that's a door that actually needs deep addressing, because that's information that for the first time in history is no longer anecdotal. To ignore that information today is to actually be delusional or asleep. So there's a new body of empirical information about death available. So let's put that aside. There's another door we could go through, which is a deep conversation on dualism, materialism, and idealism, and its structural philosophical nature of reality. And that's a really important conversation. It turns out that materialism and dualism or idealism don't pass muster. And there's a deeper understanding, maybe we would call it pan-interiority, which has enormous significance in terms of how we look at in continuity of consciousness. Let's put that aside also. Let's go into the door that you intuitively picked, because we're in conversation. This is a delight of conversation. And the door that you intuitively picked, which I'm completely intuitively aligned with you on, because it's the one that I think is actually most important, even more important than those two, is what our interior experience is in relation to death. And I wanted to throw an idea on the table, and maybe we can play with it or frame it. And in your way, your terms will unfold it, we'll change it, we'll go to a different idea. But let me just throw the idea on the table. And the idea is an idea that my friend and colleague Zach Stein and I call, and you and I mentioned it a couple of days ago at a late night call, late night my time, right? Anthroontology. Right? Anthroontology. It's a great word. Right? Anthro, human being. Ontology, you know, for realsies, for real, right? It's not a social construction. It's not a fiction. It's not contrived. It's not a fanciful conjecture. It's ontology. We can know something for real about the nature of reality, right? And when you, Andrew, describe beautifully, you know, your experience of clarity and certainty, that's an anthroontological experience, right? In other words, ontology lives within me, right? In the language of one of my major teachers, Abraham Cook, right? The mysteries are within us. So if we create a frame, the frame would be what, from an anthroontological perspective, what do I already know within me that tells me that death is actually not the final door? In other words, what I'm suggesting that we need to do is, as you suggested, we need to go back. We can't rely on, you grew up a secular Jewish kid in New York. Right? Many people in the religions don't quite believe it anymore. We have to go back and once again recreate religion or recreate spirit or recreate a shared language of value, which means we actually have to go back and be the prophet and seer and actually experience ourselves in our own first person, right? Those relationships to death that allowed, right, the creation, right, of this ability to move through death and actually transform it into not a paralyzing force, but an activating force. But of course, we need to do it, as you and I have pointed out in different contexts to each other, right, in conversation and in other contexts, we need to do it not as they did it, right? And we have to be Dawn Man and Dawn Woman. But even the fact we say Dawn Man and Dawn Woman shows we've changed. And we have to do it taking into account all of the evolutionary advances of pre-modernity, modernity, and post-modernity. So we need to kind of be Dawn Man and Dawn Woman again, confronting the first shock of existence, right, confronting death, the skulls grinning at the banquet, and then again re-access truths, but obviously they're going to be more evolved truths. I mean, that's an incredible moment. In that sense, COVID invites, in all of its pain and tragedy, which is enormous, right? There's no words for it. We could spend, right, no words for the pain, tragedy of jobs lost and suffering and lives ruined. And so just, and is not the explanation for COVID at all. It's just the fact is that COVID demands us to engage death and through it to re-energize the story. So anthroontologically, right? Anthroontologically, using the anthroontological method, in some sense you're suggesting, so maybe we'll make a list. So your first anthroontological interior experience that you're suggesting, you really suggested two, right? And maybe even three, right? You know, one is the experience of eternity. Right, meaning my actual lived experience of eternity, right? Two is, right, my experience of becoming, right? Something we've talked a lot, right? The experience of the evolutionary impulse awake and alive in me. And that both of those have a quality, a shared quality, although there's different experiences of that same quality, which is this radical goodness, right? This yes of the Big Bang. And in Hebrew, the word yes is kain, which means the ultimate, kain means integrity. Yes and integrity are the same word. The ultimate goodness and integrity of the whole thing. So there's this being and becoming, there's eternity and the evolutionary impulse, which are actually not dogmas, right? They're validated, right? They're accessible through interior sciences and exterior sciences in different ways they can be shown, right? But ultimately they're interior anthroontological experiences which tell us, if we re-access them, that we can actually engage and approach death, and they share a quality, which is goodness, right? Tamu ur'u ki tov Adonai, says the psalmist, and it was Aquinas's favorite verse, right? Taste and see that God is good, right? And the God you don't believe in doesn't exist. God, right? So kind of creating and passing it back to you now, right? Pinging it back across the net, right? That we're kind of, we can kind of develop together perhaps, right? What are the anthro-ontological experiences that already live in us? The mysteries are within us, right? Statements about the human being, which then tell us about the nature of reality, but the clarified human being, right? Not the surface human being, not the ego, right? The clarified. So pinging it back across to you with that potential context. How does that sound?
That sounds great. Well, I think that to respond to your question, I thought to speak transparently about my own experience.
Please.
My ongoing experience. So that I can tell everybody quite frankly that my ego is terrified of dying.
That's a good start.
I thought it died when I met my guru, but maybe I was wrong. So
surprise.
But the ego that's identified with the body is terrified of physical death, is terrified of mortality.
Right.
And that's something that I struggle with, I think about, I work with in my spiritual practice. And at the same time, an ongoing part of my experience is experiencing these two dimensions of metaphysical absolute reality that I was speaking about before. So it's very often that I awaken once again to this primordial depth dimension called the ground of being. And each and every time I reawaken to the ground of being, it becomes apparent to me that I've never been born, that I never entered the stream of time, that nothing ever happened, and I'm always free, and that this apparent life of the body and the mind and the personality was all a dream. Again and again and again and again and again, I realize this. I wake up over and over and over again and have the same realization each and every time. It's like being enlightened for the first time all over again and again and again. And that's in that kind of awakening. The awakening is truly complete. It's an awakening which there, in that state of consciousness, there is no fear of death, because one knows deeper than the mind can know that one has truly never been born, and that one is forever free, whether one exists in manifest form or not. And I also wanted to say that the consciousness that reveals itself as part and parcel of that kind of awakening speaks of eternity, not just to me, not just my own internal revelation of eternity, but it speaks to others, it speaks to the world, it speaks to anybody who's willing to listen. It speaks about itself. It speaks of an absolute dimension of reality in which there is nothing personal, in which the absolute alone exists. And so the absolute alone then speaks through the relative and apparent physical form of the body, the mind, and the personality. But it speaks, it wants us to know. It speaks of its own true nature, which is our own true nature, which is your true nature and my true nature. And it speaks passionately and absolutely about its true nature, which is our true nature. And it wants us to know about it paradoxically and mysteriously, it wants us to know about who we really are, passionately. And in the same way, when I awaken and reawaken to Eros, to the evolutionary impulse, to the energy and intelligence that created the universe, I reawaken once again to a kind of inspiration, a ferocious experience of love and inspiration that is extremely powerful. It's untouched by anything that's ever happened to this body and to this mind and this personality and time. And all it wants to do is bring more love and understanding and clarity and context and a great sense of urgency into this world. It sees the future, and there's a sense of being called by the future. To the future in that state of consciousness is calling us to itself. It's what Tara Bhadisha then called the great omega point. So the omega point, which is the ultimate fruition or ultimate fulfillment metaphysically of the creative process, is ever calling us to itself, and is calling us to to do whatever we have to do, as I was saying earlier, to make this world more beautiful, more extraordinary, more wonderful with everything we've got. And so as my egoic personality is afraid of death, my awakened true self and my awakened authentic self have no fear of death and are always already free. And I realize again and again and again that I'm always free and that there's nothing to fear. And then I forget and then I reawaken and I remember again. And I fall back to sleep and I remember again and I keep on remembering. And every time I keep on remembering, I thank God over and over again. Thank you for waking me up again. But it's from that reawakening that the source of this profound metaphysical or absolute spiritual self-confidence comes. And that changes everything. And as I reawaken, I realize again why I'm here and what the point of this grand adventure actually is.
Gorgeous, 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 right? And anthropologically gorgeous, right? In other words, it's an interior experience, right? Anthro, which gives you information, literal information, gnosis, right? You know, about the nature of reality. So I wanna, with your permission, friend, I wanna enter a different door. That door is so important and you said it so beautifully. So I'm gonna step away from that door and just kind of let it stand and now kind of open maybe briefly to anthropological doors, right? So kind of approaches to death. So the second one might be justice. So the experience of justice is such that we know that it doesn't happen within one lifetime. But that's an anthropological knowing, meaning it's not that we read it in a book someplace. It's not we were reading Brothers Karamazov and we saw, you know, Ivan and Alyosha having a conversation. And we figured it out by reading them. No, we actually know. I mean, anyone listening in your own lifetime, right? The sense that it's all going to work out in one lifetime justly is simply not true. There are very clearly two tracks in the world. And one track in the world is the one that our mother told us about, or maybe our mother didn't, but somebody else did, right? Right, which is what goes around comes around. There's a balance in the cosmos, right? And there's deep truth in that, right? We actually can experience that. There's a circle of reality like that. But there's a second circle of reality, which is clearly, you know, the mystics call it andrulomusia, right? It's kind of a Greek word, a kind of chaos in the world, but not chaos in chaos theory, which seeks the underlying patterns, but a chaos that's inexplicable. And in fact, it's that sense of violation of justice that moves people to atheism. You know, our friend Deepak sent me his book a bunch of years ago. And what was it called? War of the Worlds, which was his conversation with Leonard Mlodinow, who was a, just flashed in my mind right now, a Caltech physicist. And, you know, Leonard Mlodinow describes his experience, why he's essentially an atheist, right? Is because he describes a story in which his mother is in a concentration camp and he tells a horrific story about a, you know, an execution that takes place, which is completely random. And he says to identify this world in any sense, right? With any kind of larger structure of meaning, given that kind of radical injustice, right, is a violation of his own integrity. So it's funny, you read the whole book and you've got all the arguments, but it was that paragraph that actually revealed the book. That's the story he heard when he was five, and that actually drove everything. But paradoxically, when you actually go deep in our, again, I don't want to talk theoretically here, just our experience. We want to stay directly within our own first-person anthropological experience. We actually experience that justice doesn't exhaust itself in a lifetime and that we need justice. A child knows that it should be fair. A child, it's not fair, right? And anyone who has a niece or a nephew or has raised children or seen children, it's not fair, right? And we sense in our own lifetimes, in our own personal stories, right? Not the victim, I'm not talking about victim consciousness. I'm not talking about the hypersensitive self. I'm talking about the actual experience, right? When there's a failed coherence, there's a failed sense of right relationship, right? There's an injustice. And the prophetic realizers, right, who realized their realization in first person, right, in response to death, was the realization of justice that actually since, and let me see if I can just say it in a couple of sentences, since we know that justice is real, and we know that justice is real, not because somebody told us, because we have cross-cultural universal data that we've now gathered around the world, and we can also access it internally, we know it's wrong, right? When there's egregious injustice, we know that's wrong, right? We know too, that it's not worked out in a lifetime. So that tells us something. And we also know, and here's the third piece, we also know that evil itself, right? Like Leonard Mlodinow, and I grew up on concentration camp stories. I mean, the story that I grew up on literally, and I'm actually, it flashed in my mind on him. I'm hesitant to say it, but I also don't wanna hide it. But I apologize to everyone for even invoking it, but the story my mother told me were actually two major stories. And one was of her hiding. She was a hidden child in Ansbach in Poland. And she hid as the Gestapo came and ripped apart a baby while she watched the baby being ripped apart, right? I heard that story thousands of times. The defining story, right, of my childhood. We didn't do nursery rhymes. My mother would go back to this story, right? And so the horror of it, right? But the only reason that we can legitimately be horrified by that is because we live in a universe that's good, right? Because we live in an intimate universe, right? If we didn't live in an intimate universe, if we didn't have an experience that you described so beautifully of the inherent positivity and goodness of cosmos, or then evil wouldn't be a problem. It would be a non-issue, right? So the very experience of the intimate universe makes us realize that evil is a failure of intimacy, right? And so in that sense, actually our experience of justice, our experience that we live in an intimate universe in which things need to cohere, because that's the inherent structure of cosmos, and we participate in cosmos, right? Our interiors participate in the interiors of cosmos. That's anthropontology. My cosmos participate in the interiors of cosmos, which is how science works. And the only way that science works at all, and I'll let me finish this and ping it back over to you. Just, I won't do two, let's just do one now, right? But, you know, how does a scientist know anything about science, right? The only reason human science works is because we're cosmic humans, right? Otherwise human science wouldn't make any sense. And in other words, mathematics lives in Ramanujan and mathematics lives in the cosmos. And since the whole cosmos lives in Ramanujan, he can, through mathematics, right, grasp all cosmos. So that's true about exterior science, but it's also true about interior value. Justice lives in me, and I participate in the structure of justice and cosmos. I know empirically that it's not exhausted in one lifetime. I know that reality ultimately is just, right? The moral arc of the universe, right, in deep time ultimately does resolve itself, which is a direct experience. It's not theology. It's not a dogma. It's a direct experience. It matters whether you choose to be Hitler or Mother Teresa. Right? That choice matters. Even though you might get away with it in this lifetime, even though you might watch, what was Woody Allen's movie? I can't remember. It was his best movie where the two brothers and one gets away with murder. If anyone knows it, tell us in the chat box. But it was a great movie, Crimes and Misdemeanors, maybe something like that. But even though we know you can get away with it in this lifetime, doesn't matter. We have a direct anthropological realization, an enlightened realization, and that was the enlightenment of the prophets. So I want to offer that as a second anthropological experience, which allows us to know that death is absolutely not the end of the story, that this lifetime is not the end of the story, that we're clearly have a direct knowing that we're participating, right, in this larger tapestry. So offering that up into the conversation.
Yeah, thank you. So that's very beautiful. You know, sensitive, caring human beings that we all are. I very much agree with you. There's a yearning for justice. There's a yearning for that life makes sense and life make moral sense. And the more sensitive and caring we are, the more important that is to us. So my understanding of evolutionary non-duality has helped me really to come to terms with the Holocaust, as you've been describing it, and so much that happens in this world that is so unjust, it's so unfair, that's so evil, that's so painful to bear witness to and tears our heart into so many pieces. So if we have not awakened to non-duality, if we've not had that great metaphysical experience where the whole universe has disappeared and we've awakened to this, to where the universe came from, we still are either consciously or unconsciously entertaining dualistic notions that says God is somehow out there beyond the universe he created, as the great observer, as the great creator of the universe, who is seemingly allowing terrible things to happen to his children, to his creation, to his children. And why, if God is good, would he allow such terrible things to happen to us? And why would he allow us to do such terrible things to ourselves and to the planet and to the biosphere? But then when we wake into non-duality in an evolutionary context, when we realize that the whole universe is one process, and the deepest interior dimension of that one process is subjectivity and is consciousness. And with evolutionary non-duality and developmental theory, we begin to recognize that the interior, as the exterior of the universe, is in a process of continual development. And you spoke about the three Big Bangs earlier. The first Big Bang, you know, the emergence of matter and energy. The second Big Bang, the emergence of life. The third Big Bang, the emergence of mind. We realize that as the universe, as the exterior of the universe is evolving, so the interior of the universe is evolving, and the interior of the universe is subjectivity and consciousness. And consciousness evolves through sentient beings. It doesn't evolve anywhere else except in and through sentient beings. And so I came to realize that the universe, as you very beautifully describing it, yearns for, there's a moral arc in the universe, and the universe yearns for justice, for righteousness. But the universe yearns for justice and righteousness in the awakened hearts of human consciousness. I don't think it yearns for justice and righteousness in the awakened heart of a dog or of a butterfly or of a beautiful peacock. And so the universe awakens to itself at different levels of consciousness in the most extraordinary ways. But in human consciousness alone, the universe has this capacity to awaken to its own totality. And I think it's in the awakening that this uniquely human capacity to awaken to the totality of existence puts us in a very unique position in relationship to the evolution of the whole universe, because we realize that the universe, as you said, is yearning for justice and yearning for righteousness, but it expresses that yearning through human hearts, through awakened human hearts and minds. So that we realize that it's the human passionate concern for righteousness and justiceness and integrity that is the expression of God in the universe. It's that recognition suddenly elevates the significance of being human and the fact that we're actually here. Because when we feel these kinds of feelings and think these kinds of thoughts, the universe is thinking these thoughts and having these feelings through us. And the universe yearns for its own redemption through us. And we realize, and this is the deeper recognition of evolutionary non-duality, that God doesn't exist outside the universe and doesn't exist outside us. So our own yearning for justice, as you so beautifully described it, is God's yearning. And I think that we can feel that the human heart is badly broken right now because of everything, that all the challenges that our species is facing right now. And the yearning for righteousness and justice is being felt by more and more human hearts. But what's significant spiritually, just to repeat, what's significant about this is that our yearning for justice is God's yearning for justice, and that God does care. We know he cares because we care, and our caring is none other than his caring. And so I think this... The materialist reductionistic escape into nihilism because of the recognition that evil exists in the world means that God doesn't care. It's just a lack of understanding about the totality of existence and about the truly non-dual nature of reality. Because when I realized that God's caring was my own caring, that it suddenly everything made sense. Everything made sense in a way it never made sense before. And what happens then is we find that we suddenly find ourselves in a position of enormous responsibility, because if we truly believe that God's care is the highest form of care, then those of us who believe, hopefully not in a deluded way, that we're actually realizing that level of care, have an obligation and responsibility to embody it and to enact it, and hopefully in a sane and rational way. And of course that gets into very dangerous territory, but the recognition that God does not, that this this principle of absolute goodness and meaning and purpose doesn't exist outside us, but it emerges within us. And that's the expression of, that's the expression of God here and now in the world, which becomes a source of absolute spiritual self-confidence. That changes everything. And it puts us in a position to be the very individuals or the spiritual warriors or activists who are going to do God's bidding in the world and create the world as we believe in his image.
Beautiful, beautiful. So this is a great, gorgeous, and this is a great opportunity to really kind of model conversation. So here I want to take issue with a couple of things you said, which is of course where conversation gets exciting, and and right, and the ability to actually, we can kind of, in the most gorgeous sense, you know, push up against each other and see if we can clarify. And again, not in the sense of, and I want to be just really distinct here, right? Andrew and I have zero interest in scoring points. We want to actually get to a deeper truth together. So I want to play with a couple of things you said within the context of approaching death. I want to try and stay very close to our context, which is how do we approach death, the mystery of moving through death. So let me just go a couple of steps here, just, you know, two or three, just steps one at a time. So first, where we are completely aligned, right, is in this sense of, you know, when I was privileged to write in Oxford these couple of volumes called Radical Kabbalah, and we called it, you know, the core structure that it lives through, it is called non-dual humanism, right? And I think the way, what I describe as non-dual humanism seems quite close, right? And, you know, overlaps at least and drinks from the same well, right, as your beautiful description of evolutionary non-duality. So I want to just kind of line those up. And there we talked about this ontic identity of wills between the human being and the divine. And so my deepest heart's desire, not my surface desire, but my deepest heart's desire participates in divine desire, right? My deepest longing, right, participates in divine longing. My deepest caring participates in divine caring. There's a beautiful text, I actually have it behind me, right? Of my teacher, Mordechai Leiner, who writes that Noah, there's a text in Genesis where it says, "Vayomer Adonai libo," and God said to his heart. But the question is, how does Noah know what God was saying in his heart? He says in this kind of, you know, koan of classical biblical commentary, he says, because he went into his own deepest heart and he understood that his own deepest heart was listening and participated in the divine heart. So in that we're completely aligned, and the outrage at injustice that we feel is divine outrage at injustice. Yes. And here's the and on two levels. And, you know, when you read Rumi, right, or you read, let's say, a prophetic text or a Kabbalistic text or a Kashmir Shaivite text, you see this movement, very beautiful movement between first and second person. And on the one hand, right, Andrew, right, Rumi's talking about the beloved, and then falling to the arms of the beloved. And then the next line, you realize that he is the beloved. And then he's back into falling to the arms of the beloved. And there's this fluid movement in the great mystical text. And in our own experience, I think, and this is where anthropology matters. In our own experience, there's an experience of, right, realization, right, first person, tatvamasi. But there's also the sense of being held, right, by something that's larger even than me. Right. And so on the one hand, I participate, and this is in the realm of the truth that lives in paradox. On the one hand, it's all me because it's all me. I participate in it. It participates in me, and it can't be beyond me in any way. And we also have a direct experience of second person. We have a direct experience of personhood, right, of the personhood of cosmos that's also beyond me, so that, for example, the master of cuts can say, paraphrasing a text in the Zohar, he can say, every place you fall into her hands. And that's a genuine experience. And that experience of being held is not actually, right? It's not actually to be caricatured or dismissed as modernity did, right? And although it was hijacked by the religions, right? And said, oh, this is my God is holding me and your God's not. And it became an ethnocentric predicament, which waged, you know, and poured horror in the world. So yes, there were perversions and corruptions of that experience, but the core experience that there's a personhood in cosmos that actually holds me, and that is, right, and is in me at the same time, right? There's, right, because this intelligence of cosmos, And this is where I took sharp issue with Barbara always in terms of conscious evolution, right? And in other words, I don't think conscious evolution means that evolution awakens to itself in us, right? As Julian Huxley and the entire tradition, right? It's more like evolution was always awake, right? In other words, the intelligent cosmos manifested photosynthesis that all our exponentialized supercomputers couldn't do. So it's more like we awaken to the realization, right, that evolution lives in us, right? We awaken to the identity. Conscious evolution means we become conscious of the fact that the evolutionary impulse is living in us, but actually the evolutionary impulse, right, which was both third person, the evolutionary impulse, and second person, right, the beloved of Rumi, is actually holding us. And here's the last piece, and then ping it back to you, and I'm going to bring it back to death, right? But here's the last piece. I think that fairness, it's a very good question. Does fairness, right? You raise a beauty, right? Does fairness live in a peacock or a dog? Or even better, in a subatomic particle, right? Subatomic particles aren't you know, protesting, you know, for justice. So I think it does, but in a different way. When we talk about first principles and first values, what happens is, so let's say, when I'll say the universe is a love story. So I don't mean there's romantic, I don't think there's romantic love between subatomic particles. But when Whitehead talked about prehensive unification, about this allurement, right? That's, it appears as allurement. And then through the evolutionary process, matter, life, and mind, and all the stages of each, it evolves until love becomes what we know as eros and love. And then we actually become aware that we're participating in the eros of cosmos. So I think the way that fairness and justice appears earlier on is as harmony, mm-hmm. notion of harmony, right? And that notion of harmony is implicit harmony and coherence, and then it becomes fairness. So now last sentence. So if we put all that together, that would mean that we have a third anthropological door, which is personhood. So I don't believe, not because of belief, because of my felt sense of Andrew, that when Andrew passes, there won't be Andrew, right? When our friend Barbara Marx Hubbard passed, and you and I and Sally, the four of us had a gorgeous conversation only a couple of months before she passed, Barbara Marx Hubbard, I could feel Barbara after she passed. It was clear in my first person, right, that she wasn't gone, right? That Barbara-ness, and I can actually have a first person realization, which is a dimension of enlightenment, that the Andrew-ness, that reality being Andrew, isn't just where he was born in New York and the surface structures of his life, but there's a quality that reality desired Andrew-ness, and that quality may reappear differently. It may have different glasses, which would be a loss, which I've already pointed out, right? But that quality will evolve. And the truth is, the Eastern traditions slip that back in with reincarnation, right? Because there's this content, right? So I'm offering personhood, the realization of the continuity of personhood, as another critical realization that allows us to move through death, right? We actually understand we'll all be together again. And that's real, and we can feel it in our body, right? Right, Harry Chapin, right? I have this funny feeling, we'll all be together again, right? Something like that. So let me just offer that as a third possibility and to kind of engage there. Does that sound okay?
It sounds great. What we call this is creative friction.
Totally. Gorgeous.
Creative friction is only purely positive. So first of all, I can understand what you're saying, that evolution didn't suddenly awaken to itself merely when highly evolved human beings suddenly came into the scene. Evolution didn't suddenly come online, and as you said. The energy and intelligence that created the universe and is creating the universe, which we like to call the evolutionary impulse, that energy and intelligence has been hard at work for at least the last 14 billion years in an unbroken creative symphony. So evolution has been happening, man, and even when human beings were nowhere to be found, that process was definitely awake to itself, so awake to itself that it could create this miraculous universe full of galaxies and stars and atoms and molecules and living beings of all different kinds, most of which we probably have no idea about. So that's, of course, evolution's been happening for a long time. And for evolution to give rise to so much unthinkable beauty and complexity, there has to be a measure of, a measure of reflective intelligence, guiding, driving the whole process. So you're absolutely, completely, completely right about that. But at the same time, we have to acknowledge that when that process became self-aware, became consciously self-aware of itself, in and through the highly evolved minds and brains of highly developed human beings, the process became aware of itself in a way that had never happened before in the history, as far as we know, in the history of the cosmos. It might have happened on some other planets with some other humanoid kinds of minds, but we don't know if that's happened or not. But that was a big leap. So the energy and intelligence that created the universe took a big leap in self-recognition when highly evolved human beings gained the capacity to awaken to evolution, to be conscious of it. And as far as we know, that's only been true for 150, 60, 70 years. But that was a big leap. And I wouldn't want to underestimate the significance of that leap. And I think that's very much Barbara's work. She was one of the early pioneers who took that leap for all of us and was really led the way for all of us in terms of this evolutionary awakening to evolution, not just the intellectual recognition of evolution as a process in the cosmos and in life, but also awakening to evolution as a reality, the deepest levels of subjective experience. So I fundamentally agree with you, but I don't want to underestimate, just to repeat, I wouldn't want to underestimate the significance of that leap of when evolution became self-aware through highly evolved conscious human beings. That was a big leap. And this entire creative process gains a capacity for self-knowledge through us in a way that is inherently truly profound. And so what highly evolved human beings bring to this process is our capacity for self, the miracle of self-reflective awareness. So in the mirror and the reflection of self-reflective awareness, the entire universe becomes self-aware in a completely new way. And that is just profound beyond measure. And I think that, just to repeat, I wouldn't want to underestimate what a big leap that is. That changes everything, in my opinion. And in terms of the second face of God, which you were referring to, the realization of God as the great other, as the great thou, I think an inherent part of profound, deeply religious and spiritual awakening is the recognition of the ultimacy of the absolute. And so as long as we're in the body, this recognition of the ultimacy and the absolute will bring our ego, body, minds to its knees. It'll bring us to the floor in a state of awe and wonder at how great God truly is, and how minuscule as these egoic body minds we really are. As minuscule body minds, we're so full of narcissism and self-importance that we are, in the face of the greatness of God, dare we have the right to utter even a word? We just want to be quiet and bear her glory and her greatness. So I agree with you that that's an inherent part of a deep realization. Is the discovery of awe in the face of the greatness of God. And that's what humbles the ego like nothing else. And so I'm fully standing with you in acknowledging the significance of the second face of God. And and what you're implying, and I also very much agree with you that in merely the subjective experience of non-duality that doesn't include the second face of God, we're only getting a partial view of who and what God actually truly is. So I stand with you and I agree with you 100%. Now, in terms of your third point, whether Andrewness, whether Andrewness will continue beyond the death of this body and this ego, how I interpret that in my metaphysical
not frame. Surface personality, right? Not surface, right? No,
I understand that. So how I understand that has to do with my understanding of what I call the soul. So I believe that the soul is the deepest part of the self that's still personal. Still personal means still unique to me.
Right.
And I believe that all human beings have a soul. It's a metaphysical organ, we could say, so to speak. It doesn't really mean anything, but it's just a way of understanding it. And that metaphysical the metaphysical organ carries my prarabdha karma, my past karma, my present karma, and also is leading me into the future. And I think that, and that soul, the travel of that soul is the process of continuity, the continuity of Andrew-ness. And it's very funny. I've always been very recently. I've become very interested in my past lives. I was never interested before. It didn't matter to me. And I'm suddenly very interested in the law of karma, which is part of what I think you were speaking about. And so the evolution of the soul and the continuity of the evolution of the soul is part and parcel, a very big part of human evolutionary and spiritual development. And if we simply speak about the absolute nature of reality and the absolute nature of the self and the absolute nature of the cosmos, it doesn't mean that the soul doesn't play a big part. The evolution of the soul becomes absolutely irrelevant or disappears, because it doesn't. And right. So that part of Andrew-ness, I very much believe is going to be part of the continuity of this Andrew-ness. And I certainly hope that I'm on a journey of ever greater wisdom, because the one thing I'm afraid of in terms of the passing of this particular body, I don't think I'm so much afraid of death. I don't want to suffer when I die. But the thing I'm most afraid of is losing all of the hard-won wisdom and knowledge that I've worked so hard for. And I would hate to have to start from scratch all over again.
No, right. And the beautiful, right? And thank you, right? The you know, reality having an Andrew experience, right? is, right? And this notion that, and so what we're, let's bracket for now, you know, the broader conversation between the absent, the relative, and the soul and where it plays. But what we share is, I think what's really critical here is that from an anthropological perspective, if I can stay with that word, my experience of personhood, right? Both of being held, right? And of my own personhood. And let me add one dimension to it. And the fact that I'm not complete in one lifetime. And so I want to add these two parts of realization. This is an actual experience of realization. So you began so beautifully in the beginning with the experience of true self, right? The realization of eternity, that actually in that realization of eternity, I actually have no fear of death, because death doesn't exist. And I realize eternity is not everlasting time. It's beneath time, and I'm already there, and it's available. And so therefore, anthropologically, I know that. So that's the true self anthropological realization. And then we would go to the unique self realization, right? The unique self enlightenment, which would be the realization that Markness, Andrew-ness, Daniela-ness, Kristen-ness, right, and anyone else's-ness, all of us here together, right, we actually know in our first person. And again, what's key here is that it's first person. It's a first person knowing that it actually doesn't, not just from the perspective of justice. And now I'm not talking from the perspective of justice. That's a different door. This is a new door. From the perspective of unique self, my uniqueness, right, the fullness of who I am, right, the fullness of my gifts, the fullness of my range of being and becoming, the full depth, right, of my own participation in reality isn't exhausted in a lifetime, right? And often, like, we can get to the end of a great conversation, but like, we just began. And it's like, you get to the end of your life, you're like, wow, I'm just beginning to understand something, which is what you were alluding to, right? I don't want to start again. But that experience, that first person experience you're alluding to, is an anthropological experience in which I know I have a direct first person knowing that it's not over when it's over, right? That my uniqueness is actually incomplete, right? And that actually there's a realization of unique self that tells me that I'm in mid flow. And I think we're pretty close to the end of our time. So maybe I'll just throw in one last thing. So see if I can, and then you conclude for us. Or however we and maybe take some questions, but let me just see if we can recapitulate a little bit where we are. So we're in this moment of first shock. We're having to re-experience what the prophets, the seers, and the shamans and the mystics experienced. But we need to experience it from a post-postmodern perspective. And we said there are anthropological doors. So door one is eternity, right? Door two is becoming, the evolutionary impulse, which is that we're in a process of transformation. That process of transformation is ongoing and clearly doesn't end at the border of death, right? Three, the experience of justice, right? Justice tells us that there's a larger frame, right, at play. Four, the experience of love and personhood, that we could talk about a whole dialogue, but this notion of personhood, right? I'm going to see those people I love again. That actually, love does actually, right? They might not look like, but that relationship, in other words, the intrinsic quality and value of personhood tells me that it's actually not over when it's over. I actually have a first person experience, and we can try and be kind of hyper sophisticated and modern and relegate that to superstition, but actually we can also reclaim it at the level of anthropontology, right? So that experience of radical personhood, the experience of uniqueness. So that's five doors. So let me just throw one last short 10-second thing on the table, right? Because we've unpacked these five major doors, which is just the hero, right? I mean, the hero walks into the face of death. That's the definition of the hero. And the hero in Kabbalistic literature, there's a whole literature, very beautiful text around the hero. And we all, right, we watch Superman, right? You know, written by a couple of Jewish boys in Cleveland, right? And it's the hero. And we all, wow, the hero, right? We can actually access the hero. And the hero is the one who knows that there's a larger field beyond death. That at that moment when I'm called to courage, I actually realize that there's something I can walk into the face of the enemy because I understand I'm participating in a larger field. And in that sense, the hero is an early adopter, right, of this enlightened state. I like to call it homo amor, the fulfillment of homo sapien, or the new human, or the new humanity, or the evolutionary human, you know, a word that you use beautifully, or one who's realized your beautiful term, evolutionary enlightenment. But the hero is already, and the hero lives in every society. There is a cross-cultural, trans-spatial category that we all can access and relate to, because the hero speaks to the ability to actually to walk through the fear of death and to know that there's a larger frame. And maybe we live at this moment, Andrew, where we have to speak of, you know, the democratization of the hero, right? Not that everyone's an equal hero, democratization of enlightenment, not that everyone has an equal level of realization, but that actually we all can access that dimension in some way.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We should probably take questions now. Just one thing I wanted to respond to what you said, is that I just hadn't passed my 65th birthday. So that. But things change when you get older in terms of one's perspective taking, and especially in relationship to time, and also in relationship to if one is ignited spiritually and evolutionarily, and one really wants to make the world a better place, one wants to have an impact. As one gets a little bit older, like as I'm beginning to get a little bit older, I realize you're not going to be able to do it all in this life, baby.
Right. And there's an
unbearable feeling that this is going to be an unfinished project. But of course, what else is new? How else could it ever truly be from an evolutionary point of view? But I've been feeling this very acutely, very personally lately. Right. So I wanted to just acknowledge what you said. But I think we have a half hour left. I think we should probably open it up for questions.
Right. Thank you, Andrew. What a delight.
Yeah, absolutely. It's wonderful. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. So how are we doing questions, Daniela and Krista? Tell us, give us the drill, right? So what a delight, and what a delight will be to take any questions, and however form we're doing them. Are we reading them?
Yes, Mark, we are collecting them from the chat box. So anyone who would like to ask a question, please write them to Daniela. She will collect the best one and I will read them to you both. So here's the first question coming from Marcia. If people reincarnate, maybe they won't be there when we pass on. So how will we then see them again?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So who wants to, how are we going to pick up here?
I don't fully grasp the question. I'm sorry. Maybe you should take it.
Okay.
I don't understand what it means. Maybe they won't be there.
Right. No, I think, Andrew, but tell me, correct me if I got it wrong. I think what the question is, and who asked the question, Krista?
Marcia.
Marcia, thank you. And I think what Marcia's question was, and I could have gotten it wrong, so please correct me, is, well, if we have a sense that we're gonna meet again, right? We'll all be together again, and yet there's also a notion of reincarnation. Well, how do you put, it's kind of a technical question. How does that exactly work? If they've reincarnated, they've gone someplace else, right? It's great, right? So if I understand the question, that's a beautiful question. And of course, you know, clearly, you know, then I'll turn to you, Andrew, for any comment or thought on any dimension of this. Clearly we, you know, when Andrew and I talked a couple of nights ago and we said, oh my God, we're gonna barely be able to scratch the surface, right, of engaging this topic of death, which is of course we did, but I think we got pretty far. We didn't talk about reincarnation, which is an enormously important topic. Our mutual friend, Michael Murphy, you know, has said, he did it at one of our board meetings. He said, I used to say I was an agnostic about reincarnation, but I felt that I was sleazy when I said that. He said, now I actually believe, you know, absolute fact, empirical fact. And I think Michael's actually correct. We have enormous research that validates reincarnation, which is a new structure of research in the last 130 years. And Ian Stevens at the University of Virginia and his students have done an incredible job. And if you want to read one book, read the book by Professor Griffin, David Griffin, written in 1993. He's a Whiteheadian scholar on, you know, parapsychology, and the chapter on reincarnation, which analyzes reincarnation in great depth. There's an enormous amount to say. And I also have actually personal experiences. And Andrew talked about him becoming interested. You talked about your becoming interested in previous lifetimes. So reincarnation's on the table. So let me just add and of course, everything's mystery, right? So we're in mystery, and yet the Tibetan Book of the Dead reminded us that we can access the mystery. Let me just say one sentence about reincarnation. In virtually all of the traditions, we don't have a sense, and you can also access that in first person, that reincarnation means necessarily one-on-one, right? Reincarnation doesn't per se mean that Krista will reincarnate as Krista, right? It could be that a dimension of Christianess reincarnates as Jack, and in another dimension of Christianess reincarnates in a different way. That's a possibility that's raised very, very deeply in all the traditions in different ways, number one. Number two, there's also the possibility that a person reincarnates actually with their same essential quality for another couple of lifetimes and then splits into three or four different persona, right? So for example, there's a very strong idea in the lineage traditions that a particular person reincarnates as four or five people after reincarnating once or twice individually. Now, let's step back from the archetonics of reincarnation, and maybe we should do an entire dialogue about that. It's a huge topic, and clearly we're in the realm of mystery, but those things work themselves out, and I think we can hold those two truths. We can hold the empirical validation of reincarnation, and we can hold the notion that loved ones in some sense meet again and find each other, whatever that looks and feels like. Okay, thank you. Thank you. Andrew, any place anywhere on this? Sir.
Well, I really don't know anything about reincarnation. So anything I said, these are just things I think about. I don't claim any expertise on this. I've heard Buddhist masters that I've spoken with explain exactly what you just were describing, that the soul can reincarnate into several different bodies at the same time. So this, whereas I intellectually think I understand that, it's way beyond my ability to truly be able to absorb. And I realize, and if it's true, and it may be true, it shows that the structure of the universe is so much more infinitely complex than we can even begin to imagine.
Right.
But personally for me, well, a couple of things. So this idea that our loved ones will be waiting for us, I've found, even though I know a lot of people who describe this as actually being true, and people who work with people who go through the dying process say that past relatives usually show up in some form, and a conversation can usually begin a few days before the passing. So obviously there's a lot of objective evidence that would tell me that's true. But what I find very confusing about it is as we evolve, as we awaken spiritually and grow spiritually and become more and more conscious, we begin to find that our loved ones are not necessarily our biological family. And so this idea that your mother and your father and your sister and your brother are going to be the ones who are waiting for you on the other side.
That could be.
If we look at the reality of how a lot of human lives work out, that just, to me, it just doesn't ring true, because as much as I love my mother and love my brother, I've had much more intimate, truly intimate human relationships and connections with a lot more people that I have no biological relationship to. So this idea that the biological connection is going to be the primary one at the moment of transition, it might be true. It's just that I've always wondered, because if my spiritual or my soul connections with people with whom I have no biological connection, why wouldn't they be the ones who are waiting for me rather than my biological family? And so finally, the last thing I wanted to say about this was that when I think about reincarnation in terms of myself, it helps me to let go of the intense attachment to my frontal personality, to my egoic self, because even though I've known this for many, many years, and I teach this, I've been teaching for many, many years, still I realize that I'm still identified with my body. I'm still identified with my egoic personality. I'm attached in a way that is not completely yet free. It's not completely totally liberated. And yet when I realize that I can go through all of this again and feel as completely attached and identified to another form and to another personality, it helps me to wake up in a way that helps me to begin to let go of my attachment to this one. Because I continually, as I was describing earlier, awaken and realize who I really am. I awaken to a consciousness that's not identified with Andrew's personality. And in those moments, I'm free from his, completely free from the identification with his personality, but yet there's a return to it. So when I think about this reincarnational process and the fact that this is gonna happen all over again with a whole different story, which might be just as painful as this one's been, I go, oy vey, oh my God, not again. But it helps me to realize that this is so relative and so partial and so ultimately insubstantial. It helps me to let go.
There's much more to say about this, but let's take the next question. And
yeah, sure.
In our offline conversation, let's get back to this notion of the evolutionary family and our intimacies and that near-death moment, because what you point out really important. So I look forward to picking that up. But let's take the next question. Krista.
Yes. The next question comes from Court Fisher. And he writes, can one speak from this form of awakened realization to a political and economic vision?
Andrew, you want to start with that?
Well, I can't. I can't because I don't have enough understanding of those dimensions of life. But for example, you know that the great Sri Aurobindo, who was the primary Eastern realizer who really grokked evolution for the first time. I've often thought about him and why his realization was so world embracing. He embraced evolution in a way that no other Eastern realizer ever had. And if you look into his history, he was before he was a great realizer, he was a political revolutionary. He wanted to free India from the domination of the British Raj. He was a real political agitator. And he very much cared about what Bark was speaking about, justice and about righteousness. He cared about the world very much. And I thought this about the fact that he cared so much about justice and about making the world a truly just place, and cared so much. I think that became expressed later very much through his realization. And that's why I think that's part of this is my two cents, why I'm a part of my guess about why his realization embraced evolution in a way that no other Eastern realizer ever had. It was because he cared so much. So I guess his example would say there's potentially an enormous connection. And I think obviously the awakening to the totality of existence metaphysically can awaken in us a sense of care and compassion and righteousness and love that could empower our political ambitions in a way and in the best possible way, if such a thing could happen. It rarely does, but it could make our politicians characters that we could really trust and feel that we really wanted to follow their example.
Yeah, no, thank you. And Aurobindo is a great example. And I think the inquiry is fantastic. And I think it's a beautiful way to intuitively respond to the inquiry is as you did, Andrew, which is like, oh my God, that's an entire realm. Richard Dawkins, when he was asked about, you know, Brexit, he said, I'm not voting on Brexit because, you know, the issue is so complex that to actually understand the variables in terms of, you know, the hyper object, you know, a word from Metamod, the hyper object, the enormous dazzling complexity of the world economy and what the decision would mean. And he said, I can't even vote on it. So I definitely get the intuitive sense of like, this is so inordinately, you know, and I share that with you. And having said that, you know, your intuition to Aurobindo, so let me just try and pick it up in a little bit of a different way. I think we absolutely need to articulate, right, a politics of evolutionary love. Right? And a politics of evolutionary love means two things. It means we have to have orienting first values and first principles that actually generate a shared story. Because, I mean, in essence, if you think about it, where was the big meeting about COVID? We'll just do this in 90 seconds. Big meeting about COVID that was supposed to happen last January, where all the world leaders got together and coordinated action because everyone knew COVID was happening. Remember that big meeting, the big summit where all everyone met, it was televised and we all looked and said, wow, the world's really cohering in this beautiful way. We can now engage COVID. Everyone remembers the meeting, right? Of course, no one does because it didn't happen. Right? Everybody knew about COVID. Right? And yet we were unable to foster fundamental global coherence. Right? We actually experienced a global action paralysis. And that global action paralysis is rooted in a global intimacy disorder. There's a fundamental global intimacy disorder because we don't have a shared story. And that when a couple has a shared story, sometimes when I work with couples, we talk about, you have a shared story about your marriage? And if you don't, you have no ground for intimacy. And it's only a shared story that creates a shared intimacy that allows for coherence. So we can't engage any dimension of existential risk without global coherence. Global coherence is impossible, right, in the current global intimacy disorder, which is rooted in the failure of a shared story. So I think actually paradoxically, right, the creation, right, the articulation of a shared narrative, which is rooted in first values and first principles, when we actually realize that that which unites us is so much greater than that which divides us, is the single greatest political act, right, of today. So while, and I think I completely stand with Andrew, right, in what he said, which means we need real knowledge of all the dimensions and real expertise. And I stand with the humility of your initial response. I completely stand with you in that. And, right, essentially what we're doing in these conversations is to create the ground, right, issue by issue, right, of that shared story rooted in this universal grammar of value. And if we don't do that, it collapses. So I think at this moment between utopia and dystopia, this time between worlds, this time between stories, the articulation of a shared story that's a ground for a global ethos, for a global civilization, seems like the overwhelming moral, political imperative of this time. So that's you know, and I think Aurobindo is a gorgeous example, but in a more ethnocentric Indian context, you know, so I just extrapolated the Aurobindo example into a larger context like that.
Beautiful. Thank you. So we're moving between big topics here. The next question comes from Sally. Do we carry our accumulated realization with us across lives, which may explain how some people mature faster and deeper than others in this life? Is adult development trans-existence?
I very much think that we do. I very much think that we do. And I had an interesting experience. I'm living here in India, in Bangalore, in India, and I was having a conversation with another spiritual teacher, an Indian spiritual teacher. And we were speaking about Prarabdha Karma. The Prarabdha Karma is the karma that we bring with us from lifetime to lifetime. And we were sitting facing each other for about 3 hours, so there was quite a field between us. And the question I wanted to know is, why is it that some people who awaken are able to awaken to the jewel of enlightenment are able to hold on to it, and why most people, it seems, who have awakening experiences aren't able to hold on to it and fall back asleep, usually very quickly, or drop the jewel? Because obviously, in enlightenment or enlightened awareness is the ultimate mystery of emptiness. It's ultimately ungraspable and unknowable by the mind. And so even though we can realize again and again and again that it's unknowable by the mind, unless we really get it, we're going to keep trying to grasp with the mind over and over again. That's why so many people who have these powerful awakening experiences lose touch with them again and again. And I had something strange happen at a certain point when I was talking with this other teacher. I saw this little beam of light pass over my left shoulder, across my body, and passed in front of me into the room. And it wasn't happening in the gross realm. It happened in the subtle realm. It was almost like I almost wasn't sure I really saw it, but I did. And in that moment, I knew. And these are crazy moments. You know, you just have to make one has to make the sense out of them and that one will. But I knew in that moment that I'd been at this for a very, very long time. And the only reason that I didn't drop that jewel was because I had worked so hard for so long. And I knew this in a way that was not intellectual. It wasn't coming from my memory. It wasn't coming from my mind. And of course, I can take it or leave it, and you can take it or leave it. And I could have imagined the whole thing. I don't think I did, but I could have. But there was a sense of a deep intuitive recognition of I was taken back. And there was this metaphysical affirmation of the continuity of consciousness, the continuity of the evolution of the soul, and the fact that I had been doing this for a long time, and the fact that I was in the world doing the kind of work that I am now for most of my life wasn't an accident, because I've been at this for a long time. So I believe that I believe not just our metaphysical knowledge, but also a lot of the trials and tribulations and ways we suffer in life teach us all kinds of things that help to develop us at a soul level to make us the kind of people that we are. And so it's my conviction, it's a belief. I can't say that I know this absolutely, but I deeply believe that we have to be ready to learn the lessons that are inherent part of the life process and part of successes and failures and deep and unbearable suffering. There's so much to be learned, and we have to be ready to learn the lessons. And I think if we're ready to learn them, then we will carry that knowledge forward. If we're not ready to learn those lessons, we might have to go through these trials and tribulations again and again until we are at a level of the soul ready to actually to learn those lessons. But I believe that we're part of a continuity. We're part of a continuity. And I think that very much how ready we are to truly let go and to become humble and to learn will determine how much we're actually going to be able to carry, of this wisdom we're going to be able to carry forward with us.
Yeah, no, thank you. Right. And just to say to everyone, we're going to finish on time in about 8 minutes. So we'll take a couple more questions. I just want to just very briefly comment on that beautiful question, and to compliment Andrew, you know, what you said. Let me just throw a structure of reality, a kind of enlightened structure of consciousness that we can kind of access directly on the table. And I like to call it first simplicity, complexity, and second simplicity. So let's say first simplicity, wow, we go to heaven. Complexity, we get very complex about it, right? We critique in all sorts of different ways. And second simplicity, we go to heaven, right? That is to say, we go to heaven doesn't mean at second simplicity what it means at first simplicity, but actually that longing, right? The fish doesn't long, right, for dry land, right? The fish isn't troubled by the fluidity of water, right? Our yearnings are the deepest index of our true situation. And we all have an inconsolable longing for heaven. For heaven meaning, but again, you know, we like to make fun of the Christian scriptures, you know, heaven is harps being played in heaven, but they didn't mean at their best, right? We can act towards caricature, and there's a lot to caricature, and there was obviously enormous corruption in the great religions, and we need to kind of clarify that and move beyond the ethnocentric predicament. But those Christian texts didn't mean a bunch of people playing harps in heaven. What they meant was that there's a larger continuity, and there's a goodness to cosmos, and that things actually, right, in an ultimate sense, in the moral arc of reality, right, come together. And the same thing's true about the development that Andrew was talking about so beautifully in response to the question. We actually have an experience of coherence. It's a coherent cosmos. And on the one hand, we start again in a new lifetime. On the other hand, there's a continuity, right? There's a thread. Right? And the same way that in exterior sciences, evolution never forgets a breakthrough, that's an absolute law of the exterior sciences. So in the interior sciences, we never lose a breakthrough. My teacher, Abraham Cook, has a mystical diary called The Mists of Purity, or Piletor. And he says a beautiful sentence there. I'll share it with everyone, with Andrew. He says, Kevan sha'ala shuv lo yarad. Once you ascend, you never fall. Now, what he doesn't mean that you don't fall. Of course you fall after you ascend. Of course we know that. But once you actually attain a structure of consciousness, right, everything you do from that point on, right, takes that into account, right? So although it's not a circle, it's not the myth of eternal return, it's not linear, but there's a spiraling motion. And the vision of adult development, ontogeny and phylogeny, is also, we can actually access it in our interiors, which is what karma that you were talking about so beautifully, Andrew, is talking about, or whatever its details are, is that actually there's a coherent movement. We're going somewhere, right? You know, it's okay, right? It's okay, right? And we can actually know and trust reality. And then that trust is very powerful, right? Right? It's this basic trust, right? That actually, right? Wow. Right? It's okay. We'll all be together again in whatever form it is. And nothing's lost. No spark is lost from the great ensemble. And that actually is an interior truth. We know it's truth in our own integrity. And to actually wake up and live in it again and again is what it means to come alive. So let's do Chris. Andrew.
A psychic told me after my dog died and my heart was broken. I was crying every day. She said, they'll be waiting for you when you die on the other side. And I want to believe her. I don't really believe her, but I want to believe her.
Right. And dogs, we have to talk about animals. That's a different conversation, but take us forward, Krista.
Thank you. This will be our last question. And I think it's actually related. It's coming from Don, and he asks, how do you perceive intuition? Is it a knowing from a past life?
Andrew?
Well, I don't know if it's a knowing from a past life, but it's I mean, I think the power of intuition depends upon the power of trustable, the kind of intuition we can trust, depends upon us being in a place where we are feeling good about ourselves, where we actually have reached a level of self-respect. And where there's a basic level of self-trust. So we're not suffering and struggling with a lot of self-hatred, which means there's a relative degree of balance in our self-structure. So I think that's a prerequisite to the awakened sense of intuition being trustworthy, because we can intuitively feel all kinds of things very powerfully, but what their source is can often be very dubious. Just because we feel something strongly and we claim it's our intuition doesn't really necessarily mean that's what it's coming from or that's what it is. But if we've achieved a good degree of relative balance and the self is relatively well organized, and we have a powerful degree of self-confidence and a lot of trust in life, then I believe that these moments of intuition are when we are, it's an experience of feeling and knowing rather than thinking about what's true, about what may be true in relation to any given set of circumstances, or in relation to a choice we need to make, or in relation to advice we need to give to someone we care about. But it's the emergence of a deeper transcending capacity of direct knowing what is true. And I think that the expansion of that capacity usually has a lot to do with higher spiritual development. I want to tell you a magical story about my guru who had awakened powerful intuition and also he had some psychic powers. That he was on a bus trip with one of his disciples in the Himalayas, and the bus stopped and they all got out and had tea, and after everybody drank tea, then everybody got back in the bus. And just before the bus left, my guru said to his disciple, let's get out right now. And they got off the bus, and then I think they found out like 20 minutes later that the bus went over the side of the hill and everybody died. Right. So I think the powers of intuition can be profound beyond measure.
Yeah, no, thank you. Right. I mean, this is a beautiful place to, thank you, Andrew. This is a beautiful place to end. And I think your distinction, Andrew, between a strong feeling and intuition is critical, right? You can have a powerful feeling, but that's actually not intuition. And the implication of what you said, right, that we need to clarify our intuitions, and that our clarification is, it's called in interior sciences and Luria in the 16th century, Beirut, right, the clarification of desire, which is the clarification of intuition, And if I can clarify my interior desires and access my deepest heart's desire, then my deepest heart's desire opens up the realm of intuition, but it has to be clarified. But that is a genuine capacity of the human being, right? That, and an intuition is a form of personal revelation. And it's actually interesting that it was the church that tried to argue that intuition and the ability, for example, for your guru to have that psychic knowing, right? The church actually said, we burn people for that. The church burned witches for having those intuitions because the church was trying to claim that the authority of the New Testament was based on the fact that only Jesus had those powers. So therefore the existence of paranormal intuition by itself, right, was an affront to the authority of the church. And when we're moving towards this new human, towards this democratization, on the one hand, we have to actually affirm verticality, meaning we have to affirm expertise like we do in physics. We have to affirm the deep, people spend the deep work of their life, right, doing and clarifying their interiors, right, is obviously something that we honor in the interior physics like we do in the exterior physics. And at the same time, right, this notion that actually there's a democratized essence because we all participate and we can all clarify our intuitions. And maybe I'll end with this. My teacher, Mordechai Leiner, talks about there's a moment in everyone's life where they have prophecy. Mm-hmm. It's a very beautiful idea, right? You know, and where you just have a direct revelation. And maybe as Andrew did, I'll take my cue from you, Andrew, just end with a 1 second story about my direct teacher in this lifetime, Pinky Bach, who died when I was 16 and he was 32. And we're in the middle of a huge Purim celebration and he was ecstatically dancing with ecstatic, a word that I heard from you many years back and we talked with ecstatic urgency. It's a beautiful word. Right? He was dancing with ecstatic urgency. He falls down, he looks up, he says to me, you know, go on without me, has an aneurysm and he dies.
Wow.
And, you know, I stayed with the body that night and then literally without hyperbole, without exaggeration, he came to me in a dream the next night. I can literally see him this moment. He was wearing his favorite suit. He loved clothes. And he used to drive over the bridge and go through New Jersey on the way to Muncie to go to this particular men's shop to get like great suits. And there was one suit that he loved. And I lived at his house. So we had gotten that suit. He was wearing that suit. And I can literally, Andrew, like we're talking now, hear him talking to me. It was clearly a different quality of dream, meaning I remember every detail of it. Now I was 16 then. It's a few years later. And he said, the world's good. I'm good. Right? It's good, right? And he gave me a direct transmission of that goodness. And that moment is as clear to me, right, as any of this world reality. So we all have access to it, right? And Andrew, you've built your life and your experiences like that. And they're available to everyone. And thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much. It's been wonderful. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, Andrew. What a delight. Yay. Next time.
Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you, Mark. And
next time in Jerusalem.
Next year. It is.
And thank you all for participating. I would love to end this by inviting you exactly for next time. We will make a replay available and share it with you as soon as it's ready. So please feel free to share it with your friends and invite your friends. And the next conversation will be held on February 4th. And we will send you all an email to send you all the information. Thank you so much for joining us. And see you next time.